Hello everyone, and welcome to Series 2 of Laurence Plays Factorio Space Exploration. I decided that since I've finally managed to launch a rocket, it was time to sort of draw a bit of a line in the sand and start and call it something slightly different. And as an initial introduction to this new series, I'm going to have a quick recap and run through what's been happening in my base throughout the first series. So this is where it all started, and now, as is usually the case with these sort of Factorio builds, it's the area where it started is just sort of a bit of a no man's land and chaos area. So as you can see, there's the remains of my initial copper patch there. There might be some little bits of iron around as well, or I might have just scraped them all out of the ground. And there was a coal patch around here as well. But these, over the time, these initially got replaced with some ore drop stations that would drop off the iron and copper ore. And then eventually with the stations I've got now, which are dropping off coal, copper, steel and iron. So they're all being dropped off separately and then fed into the main base as required. That's a bit rubbish up there. I should probably go and fix that. I've used the wrong size of underground belts. Anyway, so that's my standard sort of progression with Factorio. I find is that you start off with your initial ore patches. You pull them up. You smelt them in on site because there isn't really anywhere else to go. Then when those ore patches start to run out, you bring in trains to bring in more ore to keep that going. And then as you start to get a bit fed up with the amount of smelting you've got because it can't keep up with your base, you then just upgrade and whack in some massive great stations. Although I still seem to be having trouble with copper, which is quite frustrating. I'm going to need to continue to look into that. We then have the initial starting point of my main bus. So here I was producing the yellow belts, and that's quite nice, small and compact. That's been running the whole time. I wonder how many it's made. 8. Okay, I must have done an upgrade in there because I've used a lot more than 8 normal belts. So let's move swiftly on from there. I then decided to build up miners because it's the order that you start to get fed up with of building things by hand in. So I got fed up very quickly of building belts, and then I decided I wanted to have the miners automated. So we've got through 1,200 of those. Crikey. And then assembly machines as well, and I've got through 438 of those. So you can see as I get fed up with building things, then yeah, it just expands. Then I needed research, so I put in this big long line of science modules here. I suspect I probably didn't build this quite as big initially. What is interesting is how far along it has to go before it gets to these research machines. Ah, yes, I remember why. That's because I also started building the burner science machines, probably in this gap here even, and that was. Because I didn't, that was what you need to use at the start. And then when I moved over to the electrical ones, it was I spread out a bit further, as you do. The other thing you notice about this is a lot of this is still using the very old style of power poles. So we've got some wooden ones in here, some basic iron ones here, and these are they're fairly crap, but they do work. And so there's no real reason to go in and replace them at this point because they do work. So I can just leave them. Random electric motor lying on the ground there. I'm not sure why. Probably because something was removed. I then started making ammunition in large quantities. This is probably about when I started having problems with biters, because as you can see, I've also started making turrets as well. And so the yellow ammunition, you can churn that out quite quickly because it only takes a bit of iron. And then later on, I added in the red ammunition as well because I needed something a bit more effective. So those two between them will tide you over for quite a while. And I think this is the only place I'm building turrets, so I am still using this supply here. One of the things I have done, of course, is I've come through. In fact, I say I've had the bots come through and replace all of the original iron chests or steel chests that I was using to collect these things with the red logistics chests, so that the bots can fly through and pick the things up and go out and place them or bring them to me or to my train as I need them. This happened later on. This whole area here was originally a green circuit production facility until I until I ripped it all out because I needed them in much larger quantities than I was able to build them in here. So I had green circuits in here, probably this whole area maybe? I'm not sure. Maybe I just left a gap. What we've got then radars, that's something also very useful. And then green science. This one doesn't seem to have expanded all that much. I think this might have been the original size I built, and I just future-proofed it quite a lot. And with a lot with this and quite a lot of the other mod packs, I find that you're not doing research constantly in quite the same way that I found I was sometimes with vanilla. I don't know whether that's just because I'm still relatively early on, so I'm doing the relatively simple researches, or whether it is just that there's so much more building to do between doing researches that, yeah, I can go in, I can set a load of stuff going, but I don't have any sort of real need for them at the moment, so that I've had less of an impetus to go in and start going. I also have only I'm just starting to need the space science as well. What's that one? Astronomic science pack. I don't know. There was one I found one of. I produced one of when I launched a rocket, but I don't know which one it was. And I don't seem to have it in my inventory, so I don't know where it's gone. Then I built up a science park. It's not too gratuitously large, but it works well enough for me. And of course they're being built off the bus as well, because there's because I needed several of them. Now, one thing that in hindsight I think I should have done differently is building these motors and these electric motors. I didn't realize quite how many of them I'd be needing and how fiddly it is. Making the electric motors is fiddly, because you also need to bring in a copper as well. These aren't the basic ones aren't too bad, because it's just iron, but having to bring in the copper as well adds an extra, a fairly significant extra step into the complexity of the builds. So I think if I was doing this again from scratch, I would have somewhere up near the beginning of the bus, I'd have a massive array of machines down here just spitting out huge quantities of both motors and electric motors, probably onto two separate belts. And then maybe I'd then also put them on. I'd have sort of extra repeaters of those every so often as I ran out, because they use fairly simple ingredients. I don't know. I'd have to have a think about it and see how it went. Maybe it'd just be one single place building them and then just having multiple belts coming out. I don't know. But as it is, this did end up being a bit of a faff. It would have been a lot easier to just be pulling these in by off the main bus. So if you're about to start a space exploration run, that's a piece of advice for you. I'd clearly developed steel by this point, so I was starting to make the proper electrical poles. So we should find that, yeah, there's still some wooden ones along here, but we'll probably find from here on outwards, yes, we're all using just the medium ones. And I did build the medium ones up quite a long time. Yes, this is just mediums. I haven't got the big ones yet, and that's because the big ones in this mod pack require concrete, and that makes them a bit more complicated to build. So I didn't bother for a while. So yeah, that was but it didn't really matter. This is clearly where I discovered trains. So we've got locomotives, wagons, fluid wagons and signals being built up here, and then I've crammed in the artillery trains here as well, so that was clearly a bit of an afterthought, but I needed those as well. And I thought, well, I'm building the motors, the engines down here, and I've got all the other train stuff here, so let's put it in the same place. I don't seem to be unloading those into a chest though, so I obviously just ran over here and grabbed them straight out of the assembly machine when I wanted to build up my artillery train. And I've actually managed to be quite careful with my artillery train. I've not had it get eaten by any biters yet. It's always been hidden behind enough turrets that it's been safe. In fact, I think the only piece of only piece of train hardware that I've had destroyed was one of my LTN locomotives. Not LTN, one of my FAL locomotives, and that was due to bad driving. I accidentally drove it into the side of another train and it blew up. So that was my own fault. I mean, technically it's Factorio, everything is your own fault, but that was directly my own fault. This area here is all about the fluid shenanigans. So we've got pump jacks for sucking the oil out of the ground. We've got various types of pipes being made. We've got chemical plants and oil refineries as well. So these are all going on into the logistics system. Oh, and pumps up here as well. All going into the logistics system so they can be brought to my construction vehicle, my construction train, and to myself. Some more science happening here. And now this is doing my fairly standard thing of the first couple of science packs, you tend to feed forwards along the bus. So they've got the belt coming along here with the red and green science being fed up to here to all the science machines. Then the later ones just get fed backwards along the bus, because at least to start with, I'll build them off the bus, because that's where all of my resources and everything is. So they'll get put onto belts like this, and then the belt runs the other way. So that'll bring them all the way back to the science area. And this sort of weird wibble in the bus here is because there was some cliff faces in here, and I didn't have cliff explosives at the time, so I just had to work around them, and they were too big to go through with the underground belts that I had at the time. The red circuits were clearly put in after that, as you can tell by the way they just go straight through the middle and have red underneath these and so on. So let's see. That was my military science, and I don't have as many machines building those as I do for the others, because I tend to find that military science is very bursty. You need quite a lot of it in little bits, but most of the science stuff doesn't involve military. So we've got these four don't, these two do, but then these don't, these don't, these don't, all the way along to, I don't know. Oh no, I can't see any more. Even that biogun doesn't require military science. So yeah, you don't need military science in anything like the same quantities as you need the others. So I've just left that as a slightly smaller machine. But it's the usual sort of thing. You've got a machine building walls over here, some building grenades, and some building piercing ammo. Filter them all through onto a couple of belts here, and then make the science. Fairly straightforward. Then I needed red circuits. So I had a facility down here on the main bus that was building all my red circuits. I've not ripped that up. I left it in place because I was hoping it would get through some of the raw materials that have been pumped into it. But it ran out of plastic fairly quickly, and so I just didn't care, to be honest. It's not in the way. I've just left it sitting there as a sort of memorial to things I needed before. Then came over here and I saw how big this lake was. I didn't have an enormous amount of stone available at the time. And at the time, I think this area over here was still infested with biters. So I decided the best thing to do would be to put a nice sharp 90 degree turn in the bus and head upwards. Now, one of the things I have done correctly here that I messed up in my Angel Bob's run is that I've managed to keep virtually everything on the left-hand side of the bus. Okay, there's a mine down here, but and a few other things like that. But basically, it's all been kept on the left-hand side of the bus. There was actually quite a lot of stone down here at one point, so I was ripping that up. So this was originally a stone mine, which had a brick production facility next to it as well, which is where this came. Why I've got this here, and that's also making my walls for my logistics network. And also making sand and glass here as well. So I think maybe the mine. Oh, here's the edge of the stone patch. So the mine was all down here. So I cobbled that in after, because the stone mine that was up here, there's a little bit of it left actually, but it ran out of easily obtainable stone quite quickly. So I need to. But fortunately, there was a bigger patch down here. Let's see. So the bus then goes upwards. What are we making here? Oh, repair packs. Those are very useful, and also boilers and steam engines for making power. My inserter production facility has moved at least once, but up here we've got most of the things here. So now I think this is all the types of inserters you have, at least in vanilla. So we've got burner, normal, slow, express, stack, and filter stack. I'm not building fast filter. I guess I just thought, well, I'll just use the stack ones for everywhere I need any sort of filtering, because they're not that expensive. Once you've got everything set up like this, it's not particularly expensive to build all of the inserters and everything. So it's no big deal. The interesting thing though is I have to because with this, with I think it's part of the AAI expansion, there's a lot more using up the older things to make the newer things. So you need to make burner inserters to make normal inserters, you need to make normal inserters to make fast inserters, you need to make fast inserters to make stack inserters. In vanilla, there's not quite so much of that. I think you might need to make fast to make stack, or possibly normal to make fast. There's a bit of this sort of the feeding through, but definitely nothing like as much. Yeah, I'm going to ignore that for now. Then explosives. So yeah, we're getting on to wanting to blow things up. Cliff explosives. That'll be why I made explosives about basically as soon as I could. Cliff explosives are very valuable for getting rid of cliffs. Just a bit of terraforming, really. And then moving on to the rockets for the rocket launcher. They were very useful. In fact, I still am using them. I think I found the rocket launcher are more useful than the tank, to be honest. Then blue science. This is quite a big one. You need all of these machines making engines, and then an enormous number of machines making the science packs. Yes, it's backed up completely, but if it was running flat out, then I think this would all be in use. Another belt production facility here. So we're making the yellows and the reds. I've not felt the need to make blue belts yet. As you can see by the fact these machines are just sitting here unused. The reds have, in fact, the yellows have been fast enough nearly everywhere. The only place I've used reds for the iron coming up here, and for the for the undergrounds when I need to go a bit further. Better assembly machines, acids, batteries, and motors up. And why am I making electric? Oh yes, this is where I made started to make construction and logistics robots. Very useful. Yes, it took me this long in however far that is in belts, in time rather, to actually get the logistics bots up and running, and get bots up and running in general rather. But they're fantastic, as we all know. concrete. Yep, that was something. That was the thing I needed. That was useful for power poles. Oh, I needed that for the roboports as well. So yes, power pole, and then lots more of the more advanced machine buildings further up. I played around with the asteroid defense thing here. Discovered this wasn't actually that useful. So this is another thing that's just been abandoned. Heat shield tiles. Yes, I needed some of those for the electric furnaces. So I've got the full range of furnaces being made here. Again, that's another of the AAI things where you make stone furnaces to make steel furnaces to make electric furnaces. In vanilla, you don't. You just make them straight off out of bricks and electrical parts, I think. But here, yes, we've got the heat shield tiles. Those are useful for rocketry as well. Making solar stuff here. Some more. Why am I making? I don't know why I'm making these up here, given that I was making them further down as well. Maybe I just forgot. LTN stations, that's important too. Tank cannon shells. These explosive shells are quite good, but the problem is with the tank, I tend to keep running into things, and that's a bit of a problem. So I've not been using that a huge amount, especially now that I've got artillery. So just to shell the biter nests into oblivion, and then just go in and finish them off with the rocket launcher. Low density structures. I seem to be running through a lot of those with all my rocketry. I only actually built these for for yellow science originally, and then I discovered how many I needed for everything else. So I think I've got another factory in somewhere up here, building them in larger quantities. But yes, at this point I realised I'd run out of things to do to an extent. So if you run out of things to do in Factorio, you make more science. So I did yellow and purple science in very quick succession. That was a lot of maths to try and get the ratios right. But yeah, we've got the low density structures, the motors to make the engines, to make the electric engines, to make the robot flying frames, to make the yellow science, and all the other things that go into them as well. And then all of the railway tracks and the electric furnaces and the modules to make the purple science, which is what, logistics science probably? Is this chemical? No, this can't be chemical. I don't know. I can't remember the names of them. Let's have a look. We've got utility science and production science. Okay. There isn't a... it's the logistics science. Of the green. Yeah, for sure. They've all got names, but I'm just going to carry on calling them by the colour. Can't stop me. Then we have, artillery. Then finally artillery. So I made an artillery train, which parks over here when it's not in use but for something else. Gets loaded up. So loads and loads of artillery shells being made. The rate I get through those, geez. 2,500. Yeah, so I've got through almost 5,000 artillery shells. Although, to be fair, a chunk of them are just sitting on the belt there. Nuclear power. That's always fun. So we've got the centrifuge being made here. And nuclear reactors being made here, and pulverizers are something different. And the heat exchangers and heat pipes. So these and turbines. So this area is all for the nuclear power, as is this. And again, there's the minor frustration of having to build up these electric motors again all the way up the bus. It would have been much, much easier. And in fact, it probably isn't too late. I could put in something along here just to start making them, and maybe I should. Then we started doing some of the more advanced space exploration things. So we've got the umbrella defense here. So this defends the planet against the wild attacks of the corona ejections. So if I look at meteor, it's not meteor defense. Coal mines is somewhere in energy beams. Here we go. Coronal mass ejection. So every so often the star goes, I hate everything, and blows out a massive mass ejection. There we go. This one is headed for Norvis, but it's not going to arrive for another 14 hours. It's going to be 182 gigajoules. That sounds like quite a lot. But this can defend against 500 gigajoules, it says so. So that's absolutely fine. I'm protected this time. And one of these will protect the entire factory, which is rather nice. So I won't have the roving fireball of doom that we saw last time. I'll link to that episode here in case anyone hasn't watched that yet. I did notice looking at YouTube, it's been one of my most popular Factorio episodes. So yeah, from that I learned that people like seeing me suffer. But that's fine. It's one of the reasons I do this. Okay, up here I started to build up some armor. So we've got the, I decided it was time to have the Mark II power armor. So, and again, another AI thing, you have to make all of the earlier precursors to make the, exciting one at the end. So feed it all the way up here, feed in the various, modules, and magically you get an armor. Then here are my here's my other planetary defense system. These massive guns. See, these are for defending against meteors. Another space exploration thing is every so often your planet will get pummeled by up to about 4 or 5 meteors, and they come in. They do a certain amount of damage. They're not the end of the world, but you get rocks like this one falling out of the sky, and as you can see, you get some interesting resources from them, which is quite useful. But they tend to do a bit of damage to anything they hit. So here's an area that's clearly been hit by one of these, either one of these or an artillery shell, I'm not sure. And there's another one over here. So this is probably a sort of scattering of 3 or 4 of them around here. And it's done a load of damage to these rocks. And if it does that to rocks, you can imagine what it does to my factory. Happily, it's usually not enough to actually destroy bits of the factory. It'll take out perhaps a couple of bits of belt or something like that, but usually it's not too destructive. But I thought these guns will cover the entire planet. They're fairly expensive to build because they need blue circuits and batteries and concrete and so on. But once you've got them built up, the ammunition's not too bad. It's just takes a... Do I have one that's got some... No, it doesn't. None of these have got the ingredients in. It takes some batteries and some steel and some green circuits. So that's nothing too bad. And then it'll shoot down the asteroids. And they tend to come in every few minutes. So every... I don't know, really. You know, when you're playing Factorio, time just disappears. They probably only come in every half hour or hour or something like that. Let's see if it says in the box text. You can change the interval between strikes, but I haven't changed it, so it's whatever the default is. Thing is, these guns will only shoot down one meteor each, which is why I've got 5 of them. And they take quite a long time to recharge after they're fired as well. So then. They work, but you need to have a sort of a bit of a bulk defense here. But that's fair enough. All my other guns are built in bulk, so yeah. Then rockets. Yes, this is the basic satellite launch rocket. So the same one is in vanilla Factorio. So we pump in a load of ingredients. So we've got rocket control modules coming from here. We've got rocket fuel that's being made somewhere else. We've got heat shield tiles, which I talked about, and the low density structures. Builds you a rocket, and when you launch a rocket, you then get to discover places, which is quite exciting. So the satellites you launch will then look out, they'll do a certain amount of reconnaissance, and you can tell basically where they've explored for you. So I've discovered various different planets and moon areas. There's Norvis, where I started, which is has a mixture of ores and things on it, shall we say. So you can, from here I can get crude oil, iron ore, stone, copper ore, coal and uranium. So that all comes from the one planet, and in normal quantities, in inverted commas. So I've got some flags up here, so it tells me I've got a rocket silo, and that's where I am. Oh no, it's where I've been there. Solar acts at 100% efficiency. It's a medium threat. I don't know what the threat refers to. Robots get destroyed at a normal rate, 7-minute days, and it tells me about the size of it as well, and priority, sure. And then we've got some other planets. So there's Myokin, which is a very vulcanite-heavy planet, but you've also got stone and beryl, yada, yada. You can read as well as I can. So it gives you an idea of what's on that planet. And all the planets have look a little bit different as well. So if I have a look at this one, this is a sort of a volcanic type planet, which is quite nice. It gives a bit of flavor text to each of the different planets you can visit, and it's got these weird pyramids on them, which I haven't worked out what those are yet, but you can see we've got massive patches of vulcanite. We've got some stone, got a little bit of uranium over there. I'm just trying to find something different. Here we go, we've got some beryl on this planet as well, so that's something different. I've not discovered what you can do with beryl yet, because there isn't any on Norvis and I've not left. Acelia is a similar sort of thing. We've got iridite on this one though, so that's a bit different. Sakimi sounds like some sort of sushi. And that's got beryl as well. So again, it's similar sort of. In fact, that looks a lot like Myokin. It's a very similar looking planet. Acelia looks sort of a fairly Earth-like planet. Zone type is moon apparently. So no, that's just what the planet. I'm sure there was somewhere. Oh, so Acelia is the moon of Norvis. Okay, of course it is. I can tell from the diagram over here. It tells you how much fuel it takes to get to it as well, from for some reason from Myokin. I'm sure there was something that gave me a clue of what the... Oh, here we go, climate. So it's a sort of... It's an earthy type climate, whereas Sakimi is a desert, treeless, waterless, volcanic planet. So it gives you an idea of what sort of places you can visit. You can also have a look at the orbital areas above the planets. So this one is orbit above Norvis. There's not a great deal here. There's some asteroids. There's a satellite here. This might be the satellite I launched. I don't know. It's got various things in it that I could presumably go up and harvest. I don't know where these came. I think this isn't my satellite because I don't have half of this stuff, so I don't know where it all came from. But maybe maybe that's something I can go up and examine and harvest and just generally plunder. I don't know. I don't really know anything about exploring space yet. I've not been up there. I've just launched a couple of satellites. So I guess the idea is you launch your rocket up there, you take a load of space construction platforms up, and then you try and build some sort of bridge system out. And I don't know. But I am looking forward to finding out. Okay, let's go back to me rather than the map. Where had I got to? Yes, here we go. So I've saying launch satellites. You can see I can see around. Satellites being made here. And then there's a few more things. So the next step up is building these cargo rockets, which is now finished. Actually, that was I was leaving that running building while I was off doing something else. So it's nice to see that's actually finally finished. There's a few things you need for this. So I had to build a cargo rocket silo, which is different from the normal rocket silo because it's bigger, as it takes these bigger rockets that you can do more with. And I build landing pads as well, so I can take that with me when I go up there and set somewhere where the rocket can try and land. And I think at the moment, I think if you don't have a landing pad, the rocket will always explode on arrival. Although I think its cargo is salvageable. If you do have a landing pad, I think you then have a probability of the rocket landing successfully. So it's probably a good idea to take a silo and all the bits to make another rocket with you so you can get back again. And there's also a pod that you can build on your... you need as part of building the rocket and various other bits and pieces. So this is all being built up here. Yeah, so that's all good. And that's as far as I've got along my bus. So that's been all of space exploration, all of what you require in space exploration in your main base to try and get you into space. Now, that's all very well. There's been a bit more to it than that, though, because you can't just build... I mean, that's all the stuff that's done the building. But then you need a few other things as well. So I've built some factories out here. This one makes all of my green circuits. So I've got stone, iron... No... stone and copper being delivered by trains here, and that's being made into the green circuit, which can then be picked up by train and taken off elsewhere. Over here I've got the same sort of thing with red circuits. So these patterns will look very, very familiar to you because they're exactly the same as the ones I used before. So I've got green circuits being built here, being made into red circuits. So that means I've got plastic, stone and copper coming in and red circuits going out. I've got loads of them, that's great. Blue circuits over here, well, I don't have any copper because copper has been a problem and blue circuits are really expensive. But at least I've got 82,000 blue circuits in here. So that's basically okay. I just need to fix my copper supplies and work out what's going on there. I've got done some core mining here. So this is another space exploration thing where you build up... you build up these core miners. They rip chunks out of the heart of the planet itself, which you then pulverize down and split up into loads of different ores. I can't show you this running because it also produces water, and that's why there's an alarm going off here, because these water tanks are all full, and so I can't. So the machine's all ground to a halt. I could go out there and empty them. I haven't yet. What else have I got? I've got oil processing going on here, so that's a fairly big thing. Basic oil processing running here, so it's taking in crude oil and turning it into petroleum gas, which then gets turned into plastics and sulfur, and those get trained off to wherever they're needed. And then up here I've got a larger facility which is doing coal liquefaction, so bringing in massive quantities of coal, turning it into gas, or turning it into all three types of oil, then turning those down into petroleum gas. I've got loads of that. This is all running much, much faster than I need it, because the base isn't doing very much at the moment, mostly because I've been spending all my time fighting recently. I've got an LTN depot here, which is all broken horribly. Oh my god, my trains are... Oh, that's my fault. what? Oh, it's because I've left an artillery train here. Go away. Right, so because I left the artillery train here, everything has gummed up completely, and oh my god, this is going to be a massive headache to sort out. Someday, I'll learn not to do that. Yes. So this area here, since I'm here, is my external smelting array. So as I mentioned, I started off doing all my smelting on the main bus. Eventually, I got to the point where it wasn't producing enough, and I needed metal in other places as well. So I've got the ores being brought in here, dumped onto the bus, and they then get passed through onto a train on the other side that'll take the copper away to wherever it's needed. And so that's working quite nicely. This is quite nice. This is the new 1.1 lighting effect. So we've got the glow coming out of the furnaces rather than it just being a pool of white light over the entire machine. That's it looks quite nice, especially when you zoom out a bit and you find ones that are in heavy use. He says, waiting for the stone to filter a bit further through so everything kicks into action. I don't know why these ones aren't running. Oh, everything's broken. I'm gonna need, yes. I've then also got lots and lots of mines scattered around the whole place. We did got some oil coming from here. We did have copper coming from here, but it's basically gone. For some reason, those don't have power. Never mind. There's another copper mine here. Recently, I expanded out over this way. So I've got two big copper mines and three stone mines, and those are all working really well. So, yeah, that's basically where I've got to. It's been a big job. Oh, I've got nuclear power happening over here, and uranium ammunition being built here as well. Quite slowly, though, admittedly. I need some more uranium mines. But this is all working reasonably well. So in that video, as you can see, I've found a few things I need to go in and fix. But otherwise, that's basically how the factory is running at the moment. This is my LTN depot, and the reason which is where all the trains should be most of the time. This is where they live when they're not going off and transporting stuff around for me. There's a lot going on at the moment because I've just cleared a massive clog out, so everything's trying to refill. That's probably why there was no raw materials in my blue circuit production facility. So yeah, as you can see, the copper has now arrived. So that's going through and filling up the belts again, and everything will start to work again now. Okay, so that's been Space Exploration Series 1. I hope hope everyone's enjoyed it, and will be coming back for it to see me take this. Well, the old one small step for man, a giant leap for mankind bit. When I go off to find some moons, or at least I think my first step, I think, is going to be to go into space and have a play around in that, have a look, investigate that satellite I saw up in orbit. From there, then I'll go off to the moon, I guess, investigate beryl and iridium, I think it was, whatever the two metals were. And then from there, well, I'd say the sky's the limit, but it really isn't. Well beyond the sky's the limit. So I hope you'll come back and join me for all of that. And I'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.